Progression of the physical. See, I'm not a physical scientist, so many of you are physicists, so please forgive if I'm sure I will make wrong statements, so you correct me and forgive me if you think if I'm telling anything very wrong. I think that the development or the trajectory of the physical sciences in this post 50s very much again reflects this sort of this postmodernism deconstructionism. If you think of it, the entire idea of a very ordered, structured atom with a nucleus in the middle and this electrons going around it, you know, in predetermined orbits, which were established by a large number of people before that, you know, de Broglie and with the Aufbau principle and all, is completely destroyed now, if you think about it in that way. We now have a much more fuzzy picture of the atom, that sort of a very structured thing. Which is very, which is surrounded, which is around individual particles. Okay, is completely gone. And if you think about it, one of the main things of this time, the product of this times, is the uncertainty principle, where basically there is uncertainty about the position and the momentum of a particle also. Therefore, a particle can both be energy and matter. So this thing is very much, I think, would say, in at the level of the thought process, very involved with relativism. Okay, and relativism is basically, I would say, the driving force in postmodernism or deconstruction. Relativism says that all sorts of approaches or all sorts of outlooks are equally valid. Okay. That is the basic motivation of postmodernist or deconstructionist theory. And you would see relativism now very much in the center in the physical sciences, because it is based on the idea that there is the material reality can also matter, can be energy, it can be matter, it can be in multiple places. The ideas of these multiple dimensions, the idea of quarks, etc., is all corresponding to the idea of relativism. Which is very much there in postmodern thought. So again, the question is that there was no real, you know, impetus to go in that direction. If you think about it, if you look at Einsteinian relativity and you see where the impetus was at the time of the Second World War, okay, beyond that, where the direction it has taken, again there was no real logical progression towards it. Okay, it seems that there was something happening in society that gave up all this rise to these theories. Okay. And that is also very interesting. Yeah, I hope someone writes about it.
But uncertainty principle is a basic principle in quantum mechanics.
Yeah.
Of course, postmodernists use this principle to tell that everything is relative or knowledge is subjective. But are you trying to tell that a discovery of uncertainty principle itself has something to do with this postmodernist
approach? That is a completely other way around. What I am telling is that at a certain period in time, in a certain social context, the theories which come up in science, okay, they all describe real material reality, but they are somehow tied, okay, to also the dominant thoughts of that period. It does not mean that
The interpretations.
But uncertainty principle does not lead me to accept this postmodernist.
No, should I tell you? Same with me also. See, when I see genetic some gene causing an effect, that does not lead me to accept, capitalism, which puts genes or individuals at the center of the thing. I'm not telling that there is this 1:1 code that if you believe or if you accept this, you have to accept the other. What I'm telling is that the era in thought which produces this sort of thoughts in the social world also is the same time somehow it acts an impetus for the development of this interpretations of the natural world. Okay, with those interpretations being correct, I'm not saying those interpretations being wrong. So it's a sort of a difficult thing to sort of accept, and it always seems that no, that somebody means the person who discovered uncertainty principle was himself or herself influenced by postmodernism. It is not the case. I'm saying the entire social milieu in which uncertainty principle was propounded and was accepted, okay, was a milieu in which deconstructionism, relativism, subjectivism are also an accepted dominant thought in society. That is what I'm trying to say.
But so that's why it has some kind of source in society, and that is class.
Yeah, that is the thing. It is finally class. That's what I'm saying. It is the class, because in the post-1950s, there has been this postmodernism, has been this dominant sort of thought in the, at least the Western world, based on the way capitalism has developed in the Western world.
This discussion is that it's been difficult for the house, so maybe this discussion we can if there are any other questions from the research scholars, and from my side, if you say something about the research scenario in the today's context, like what should be the, mostly what we have so far discussed is the history or the change in philosophy of science or
right,
the history of progress of science. Mm. These are very useful things, but maybe what we thought of today's discussion is something is will end in the today's context.
Hmm.
So maybe you can talk something about the of it, or if there are some questions about.
Yeah.
Actually, can I just ask the first question if you don't mind?
Hmm.
The direction in which Munmun tried to take the discussion and what we were discussing, I was just wondering whether it might also be true, because I'm also from genetics background, so I was just thinking about Mendel, that if the acceptance of the idea, whether it could be the other way around, like when a scientist proposes something, it depends upon the social milieu, whether what he says is accepted.
Absolutely.
That depends upon the dominant discourse of the time.
Yeah, absolutely.
Like even if someone thought of particulate physics hundreds of years back, perhaps that would have been shunned because that was not the norm at that time.
Yeah. So you have brought this discussion to a more practical level. Okay, so that's what I think. So what he's trying to say, and that is what I think finally happens, means although it is very difficult to establish this empirically,
but
is that
I think it's empirically happening all the time.
Yeah,
right?
That's what's happening. So what is the theory which is propounded, whether it is accepted or not, will finally depend on the social milieu possibly. That is where the real connection comes. Okay, the uncertainty principle, if it was proposed in the end of the 19th century, it might not have been accepted. Similarly, if Darwin had proposed his theory of evolution in the 12th century, it might not have been accepted socially. Okay, if Newton had proposed his theory in the 19th century, it might not have been accepted in that way. So that what you are saying, I think, is the finally the crux of the matter. The acceptance of a scientific idea will, and acceptance and the propagation of the scientific idea, okay, in the scientific community and in the greater social community, will be dependent on the dominant social context of that time.
No, okay. Not only that, the material condition.
Yeah, material
some
condition.
Other discoveries.
Yeah,
some,
yeah. The material conditions determine the dominant social reality. All the other discoveries, the what is going on in society at that time, etc. So all these
that's
things.
That's why uncertainty principle could not be proposed some 100 years back,
it
because
might have
material
been.
Condition was not there.
Perhaps what he's saying, that some technological, like we would understand, like discovery of virus or something, like until and unless microscopes, like there are technological advances, some of the basic scientific advances couldn't happen. But
see, that is not always the case. See, many of these advances happened much before this technological things happened. For example, viruses, they were originally like proposed much before like microscopes were discovered, for example, and they were accepted also. Means viruses, not by the name of viruses, but by you know, like germs which can carry disease from one organism to other.
Even genes in the first place were termed as factors.
Right. Yeah. So the names are something which comes in later. The actual material condition. So technology driving the progress of science, it has happened, but it is not the true for the entire history of science. Yeah.
Also, it is the other way around. Some technologies are encouraged in that period.
Right. Yeah.
So no, that's one.
That fits in with
very much. Yeah. And I give an example of the steam engine.
That's why material condition does not consist of technology only. It is many things.
Many things. Combination. Many things. Yeah. Basically. Yeah. So what Moon is asking? Yeah. And I think that leads from here. This was a much more of a philosophical discussion, I would say, a discussion about which we should be aware. The question then comes is that what is the reality of the research that we are doing today in the social context that we are today? There are a certain, I would say, overarching features of this research, of the thing. Number one, research has ceased being an individual activity, okay, a long time back, and it is now a social activity. That is something which we should understand. Means the sort of scientist who was modeled on Professor Shonko. How many of you have read Professor Shonko? Okay, he is a very popular, fictional scientist in Bengali literature, created by Satyajit Ray, who would work alone in his laboratory in Giridi. Okay, where he would discover all wonderful things is not a reality anymore. Okay. But Professor Shonko is modeled on real researchers of his time, okay, of coming from the classical alchemists like Ibn Sina and all, up to Lavoisier, Rutherford, etc., Faraday, okay, who is to work alone in their labs. Even J.C. Bose, you can think of that, work in the labs and do great discoveries. Okay, so the entire praxis of science, or the praxis of research, has changed from there. Now science is a social activity where you are part of a collective. Okay, you are a part of a collective, and there is this collective works in various levels. You are part of a small research group in most cases. Okay, the research group is part of a larger organization. Okay, then the organization or your group is part of a field of research. Okay, then it is part of the entire scientific community to some extent. All right, and at every level, therefore, you have certain responsibilities. Okay, because you are part of collectives now, or we are, or I am a part of a collective now. So my research is not therefore guided now just by my own wants, my own needs, my own desires, my own aspirations. It's because they are all now collective aspirations. That is one thing which we should understand very importantly. Okay. And therefore, our research also has to be done in a way that where we are part of this collective process in terms of what research questions we are addressing, how we are doing that. Research, the way we are doing it, that means whether we are...
In this respect, I have a question.
Yeah.
Actually, in the abstract, what they gave regarding your talk, there's a mention of ethics in science.
Right, okay. Yeah.
Now, I thought you touch upon this aspect, that this research problem, etc. thing, that you didn't get into that issue of funding companies, corporates, etc.
Yeah, yeah. I'm coming.
So
to
I think you should.
I'm coming to that.
Aspect.
Yeah. So
line of instruments, big instruments.
Right. So the second major thing which has changed in this research activity is the source of the funding. Previously, people used to do research from their own pocket money. Okay. Now the research is done by external funding. Okay. So the funding comes from two major sources. The one major source is public money, okay, where governments, where like for example the government of countries like India, which have taken up science and technology, progress in science and technology as a national mission, okay, they will put in large amounts of money into research, okay. And the other is money coming from individuals, okay, or corporations who are trying to develop research as something which will finally give them some material return. Alright, in terms of profit. So we should understand that. So here all these questions of ethics, of responsibility comes. When you are doing research and your funding comes from a public source, okay, your funding comes from the government, for example, your own fellowship comes from the government, the research grant comes from a government granting agency, alright, what should be your ethical responsibility to? Okay, and the way this thing is structured, I would say is very unfair. I told that in that day in the other meeting also, is that people generally pay for research twice. Okay, how? For example, there is a medicine which you buy in the market. Alright, the original research for that medicine was funded by some government agency, by taxpayers' money, by public money. Okay, and then you discover the thing and then that product or the technology to produce that product goes to a private company, which then again goes and sells it to the public. Okay? And the public pays for it twice. Okay? And we never think of this thing. That for any research, for anything which you are buying from the market, which is a product of scientific research, you are paying twice. We never will do that. Do you think that if you go to a shopkeeper, you are going to pay twice for the one item you buy? Okay? We never do that. But in this case, we are always doing that. Alright? And this is a model which was developed in America, in the US. In the US system where I work, this is the rampant method. That a government there, most of the biomedical research funding comes from a government agency called the National Institutes of Health, NIH. They give the money, and then the research is done in universities, okay, and institutes. From there, the discovery or whatever technology or the product goes to the private company. The patent is sold to a private company. The private company apparently invests money in the technological development, in clinical trials, etc., and then sells it to the public and again gets money from it. Recently, there has been research, very good research actually, I saw, which has come out in some Indian newspapers also. I think you sent it or someone sent an email with this paper to me, where they have shown that the actual contribution of a private company to the product which comes out in the market is only 3% in terms of finances. Okay, 3% only. The rest, everything, 97% comes from public funding. Although the company then gets 100% of the money.
Taking away 97%.
Taking away 97%. So this is the basic structure of this process. All right. So this process is anyway, I would say, is in a very unfair unfair means. And this is something which we should be aware of. Then the question comes together with this of intellectual property. Okay, intellectual property and the way intellectual property is handled. I guess some of you know that there has been over the last two decades or so, there has been a large worldwide, you know, thought and questions on intellectual property, which has finally been sort of established by this WTO. Okay, and the TRIPS regime. Okay, the TRIPS regime is basically the way the intellectual property rights or patent rights are administered all over the world, and all the signatories, all the countries including India, are signatories to this process. Okay, whereby this the intellectual property of discoveries, etc., are now much more controlled. Okay, they are much more in the hand of individual or smaller entities rather than being publicly available. So this is also one thing which is a very dominant theme in science, in scientific research today. And therefore there would be all sorts of conflict which you would face, means while doing this thing. Maybe, for example, you discover something, your research advisor wants to patent it and then sell the patent to some company who will try to get something out of it. But remember, as soon as you patent it, you will not be able to publish on it anymore. Okay, because now it becomes the basically everything related to that technology or that product becomes the property of that particular entity. You will not be able to publish it in that way. So this is the sort of thing which we should be conscious about. So this entire thing of intellectual property funding, etc., finally boils down the question that what are the rights or where is the voice of the researchers who are actually doing the work heard in this entire process? That is the final crux of the matter in which I think we should discuss. Okay, everywhere in the world, now as I said, as the science is no more individual activity, it's not that you are the PI or the research advisor doing the research himself, it is mostly the research scholars or the postdoctoral fellows, the research scholars in India, postdoctoral fellows in the US who are doing the research. Their voice is nowhere in determining this major scientific policies, neither at the national level nor at the international level. Although they are the majority, the vast majority of the scientific community. Okay, in India, I think around 80% is around research scholars. Okay, in the scientific community in India, 80% is research scholars, 15% are faculty members, and 5% are other scientific workers. So 80% of the community in India, there is no voice of them heard. okay, there is no, their rights, their thoughts, their aspirations are not reflected in any scientific policy, in any discussion of science. Similarly, the same cases are with postdocs abroad. So I think that is a very important matter. Therefore, research scholars should, that's why that's what my motivation was to talk about all the philosophy in the beginning. Because you understand that whatever you are doing is in a larger social context, okay, where you are the majority, and majority is a vast, vast majority. Okay, there your voices, your thoughts, your aspirations, there is no space for it. Okay, and policies are being made, okay, policies which are supposed to make India, you know, like the fourth power in the world in terms of science and technology in the next 20 years or the next 10 years or so. The recent National Science and Technology Policy tells that, actually. So I think that there is important that research scholars talks about the trajectory of science, going beyond their day-to-day laboratory work. Okay, and form fora like this where their voices can also be heard, okay, in the greater enterprise of science, not just, you know, like getting a equipment or getting the fellowship enhanced or getting good treatment from your research advisor, which are all rights, absolutely, okay. But beyond that, in determining these questions, okay, in determining policy, I think research scholars and postdocs should have a much larger role, and people should be conscious of that. All right, we should first be conscious that you do not have any voice, and secondly that you should have a voice, okay, because it is not something which is just, you know, like the experiments you are doing. It is much, much beyond that, which I hope the discussion makes it clearer.
এটার ইস্যুতে একটা ধরুন এলএইচসি এক্সপেরিমেন্ট, ওটা আমার একটা এস্টাবলিশড থিওরি এবং সেটা নিয়ে তার পরবর্তীকালে ফার্দার ওয়ার্ক অনেক দূর এগিয়ে গেছে এবং ব্রিলিয়েন্ট থিওরি, সেটাকে আমাকে একটা ফার্ম এক্সপেরিমেন্টাল ফুটিং এর উপর দাঁড় করাতে, এইটার একটা গুরুত্ব আছে। অ্যাজ এ সায়েন্সের স্টুডেন্ট আমি যদি এটা বলি এটার কোনো গুরুত্ব নেই, তাহলে আমি মিথ্যে কথা বলবো। এটা অত্যন্ত গুরুত্বপূর্ণ ভূমিকা আছে, কিন্তু অন দ্য আদার হ্যান্ড এই এক্সপেরিমেন্ট করতে যে বিরাট খরচাটা হচ্ছে, বিরাট খরচাটা হচ্ছে, তার থেকে ধরুন এগ্রিকালচার বা যেগুলো অনেক সহজে অনেক মানে ডাইরেক্ট ওয়েতে তার সোশ্যাল ইমপ্লিকেশনটা আমি দেখতে পাই। আমি যদি বলি যে এগুলোকে ডিপ্রাইভ করে আমি এই এই এটা করছি, সুতরাং এটা ঠিক না, এটাও তো আমি বলতে পারবো না। এই ক্ষেত্রে স্ট্যান্ডটা কি হওয়া উচিত, কারণ এই এক্সপেরিমেন্টটা করানো প্রয়োজন আছে ফ্রম এ ব্রডার সাইন্টিফিক পার্সপেক্টিভ।
মানে আজকে কাজে লাগলো না, 20 বছর পর কোনো একটা এতে যেখানে পৃথিবী হয়তো ধ্বংস হয়ে যাওয়ার সম্ভাবনা আছে, সেখানে হয়তো এই ইনফরমেশনটা কোনো কাটা কাজে লাগলো, সে তো আমি কেন সেটাকে বাই স্টুডেন্ট আই ডু ইট নাও অ্যান্ড বি একুইপড আন্ডার কন্ডিশন দিস মাই বি রিকোয়ার্ড, এই প্রশ্নটা সবসময় আসতেই পারে। মানে সবসময় এই প্রশ্নটা সে দাঁড়ায় যে আমার যে আশু যে সমস্যাগুলো, যে আশু যে নির্ভর ইমিডিয়েট নিডস, ইমিডিয়েট কনসার্নস, শুড বি put all our efforts or majority of efforts behind that, or should we look at a longer perspective? A prashna will always be there in front of science, okay, and there is really no clear answer to this. I do not have a real clear answer. Now, if you ask me from my heart, I will say that no, all those research should stop and all research should go into this immediate you know, like those concerns, okay, agriculture, health, etc. All right. On the other hand, if you ask me to think from my mind, I might say the other possibility is also there, that research might be useful, because all knowledge is useful. Okay. Knowledge is also something, knowledge is also empowering. That is also another very important thing. Knowledge is empowering. Whatever source of knowledge is empowering. Question is that, who has the control of the knowledge? Okay. See, this entire debate about genetic engineering and biotechnology, okay, I think that those knowledge about genetic engineering, biotechnology, to be able to transfer genes from one organism to another organism and change properties of the organism, that knowledge is empowering. Question is that who has control over the knowledge? Okay, is it the farmers who have the control over the knowledge, or is it a multinational company who has the control over the knowledge? Okay, so the same thing with this LHC or this sort of this mass scale experiment. Money,
if you just allow, there is, I think, another way to answer this question also. is that even if you compare the cost that is being undertaken in CERN, even that is minuscule when you compare the amount of money being spent in military budget.
Right.
Even that is minuscule. You just add the military budget of a few countries, that goes nothing with that budget of CERN. So if you just curtail that budget, huge amount of money that is being spent.
Hey, man, a direct equivalence to establish kora shetu. সায়েন্স এর মধ্যে ইকুইভ্যালেন্সটা এস্টাবলিশ করার মানে এ করাটাও ডিফিকাল্ট এর মধ্যে, কারণ যেখানে উই আর টকিং অফ দিস নলেজ এটসেট্রা. হ্যাঁ, মানে জেনারেল লোক, আমি এই এই এটা আমি এই অডিয়েন্সকে বলবো না, বাট আমাকে যদি রাস্তায় যদি কেউ এই প্রশ্ন জিজ্ঞেস করে বা কোনো একটা পাবলিক মিটিংয়ে যদি কেউ প্রশ্ন জিজ্ঞেস করে, আই টেল দ্য সেম থিং বেসিক্যালি, যে ইফ ইউ লুক অ্যাট দ্য মানে ইফ ইউ লুক অ্যাট দ্য বাজেট অফ দ্য মিলিটারি, দ্য ডিফেন্স ডিপার্টমেন্ট বা মিনিস্ট্রি ইন ইন্ডিয়া অ্যান্ড দ্য বাজেট অফ দ্য ওই ডিবিটি ডিপার্টমেন্ট বায়োটেকনোলজি, তাহলে দেখা যাবে যে ওটা হচ্ছে সো দ্যাট ইজ দ্য ইজি আনসার টু দ্য ফর দ্য পাবলিক. কিন্তু আমাদের কাছে কোয়েশ্চেনটা একটু ডিপার, এই যেটা তুমি প্রশ্নটা করলে, আমি অত ডিপার এ থেকে এটা করলাম. সো আই থিঙ্ক দ্যাট ইট ইজ রিকোয়ার্ড মেবি, মানে অ্যান্ড ইফ ইউ হ্যাভ টু ফোকাস অন রিয়েলি গেটিং রিসোর্সেস ফর গুড অফ পিপল, দ্যার আর সো মেনি থিংস মানে উইচ শুড বি উইচ নিডস টু বি কার্টেল, উইচ নিডস কমপ্লিটলি স্টপড এর মধ্যে. There are so many things like that.
One question regarding the first part of your talk. That is that you were saying that the earlier philosophy was to find out an order. Somehow you have to find out an order. And when this new school of thought coming up, the rationalist school of thought or the bourgeois school of thought, whatever you say, they are questioning everything, right? But these new questions that they are that are cropping up, they are actually trying to search for an order at an even higher plane. So they are trying to find out laws and rationals at a more complex or at a more higher plane. Whereas this relativism or postmodernism, whatever you say, that is trying to break the order that you don't need any laws even in higher plane. If this can be a law, that can be a law. This is also an explanation, that is also an explanation. So that is not something which a scientist goes with a scientist philosophy. A scientist also tries to find out a law, or if you term it order, he is also trying to find out an order. But he is trying to find out an order in a much complex or a much higher plane compared to what it was in the feudal society.
No, what I am telling is that the what you call as order itself has become much more, if you think about it, you would be better able to tell me in terms of like the modern physics and all, that terms of order itself has become much more varied, if you think of it. This order is no more like that very structured order. Jekhani dajan uncertainty principle, among tarpor quarks, etc., mass,
so it is
energy.
It's difficult to find out the order from there.
Right, yeah.
But we are in search for such orders.
Orders, but the order itself, the structure of the order itself is no more so stable. That's what I'm trying to say. And that is what basically this entire, the last 50 years has been socially also, if you think about it. The things such as you have choice has become a very important buzzword in the entire society. It means we are sold choice all the time. All the advertisements in the television are selling us choice. Okay. So it is basically the question of choice. So you can choose between this reality and that reality. Okay. And there are possibilities under certain conditions, certain frames of reference. This reality is correct and another frame of reference, that reality is correct. The accepted thing, I think, in ideas. That you can have multiple realities depending on multiple frames of reference. And both are correct. It just depends on the frame of reference of the observer. Okay. The same thing.
But here also you have to create the synthesis. The synthesis you are talking about. This is one antithesis, this is one antithesis. You have to create the synthesis.
That is fair.
And that is becoming difficult because the order of the complexity is also.
Absolutely. So that just, and that reflects the social complexity.
আমি দুটো জায়গায়, একটা হচ্ছে পোস্টমডার্নিজমের জায়গাটা যেটা বলছিলেন, আমি ঠিক আনসার্টেনটি প্রিন্সিপালের জায়গা থেকে ভাবি, এখন কোয়ান্টাম মেকানিক্স এবং তার কথা পরবর্তীকালে ফিল্ড থিওরি এবং আরো বেশি জেনারেলাইজ যখন হয়ে যাচ্ছে, সেক্ষেত্রে অনেক সময় গেজ ট্রান্সফরমেশন বা গেজ ফিক্সিং এরকম কিছু পদ্ধতির মাধ্যমে আমি একটা বড় ক্লাস থেকে একটা বড় সেট থেকে একটা ছোট সাবসেট চুজ করে নিচ্ছি, করে আমার ফিজিক্সটাকে আমার এটাকে আমি তার মধ্যে কনফাইন করে নিচ্ছি, আমি এইভাবে ডিকনস্ট্রাকশনের সঙ্গে রিলেট করতে চাইছি।
সেটা তো সম্ভাবনা বিভিন্ন, আমি বলছি যে ফ্রেমস অফ রেফারেন্স এর আইডিয়া, এটাই তো রিলেটিভিজম। মানে আমি একটা ফ্রেম অফ রেফারেন্স থেকে একরকম জিনিস দেখছি, আরেকটা ফ্রেম অফ রেফারেন্স থেকে আরেকটা জিনিস দেখবো।
তুমি ফিজিক্স এর রেফারেন্স রিলেটিভিজম বা পোস্টমডার্নিজম যেটা বলে যে নিউটনস গ্র্যাভিটেশন লটা ওরকম, তার কারণ